The Oort cloud may not exist, and I'll explain why. The Oort cloud is a mysterious entity. Located at the edge of the solar system, this hypothetical region is likely the source of long-period comets that occasionally venture close enough to intersect the orbits of the inner planets. However, there's a catch. The existence of this cloud has only been hypothesized and never proven. Believing in its existence is, therefore, an act of faith. Stick with us until the end, because that's where we'll present our own alternative hypothesis to the Oort cloud. The Oort cloud is a fantastic cosmic creature. It's like the mythical Arabian Phoenix that everyone says is there, but no one knows where. No one has ever seen it. It's a shell of debris that encases our solar system. It's a swarm of nocturnal butterflies crowding around the light of the sun, a dynamic system of large cometary nuclei lazily orbiting our star with periods of tens of millions of years. Think about it. Billions of enormous ice blocks slowly drifting in the darkness of outer space, like invisible icebergs, faintly illuminated by a sun that, at that distance, shines no brighter than Jupiter is seen from Earth. Hundreds of billions of icebergs completely invisible from Earth, not just individually, but even as a cloud. Any optical, radio, infrared, or radar technique is powerless to reveal them. So why do we stubbornly insist that this monster that contains us all truly exists? It's hard to admit, but practically the only convincing evidence we have is the existence of long-period comets, nothing else. For thousands of years, astronomers have observed comets approaching Earth and lighting up the night sky with their erratic appearances. Over time, these observations naturally led to a series of questions. Where did these objects come from? Sure, their surface material vaporized as they approached the sun, forming long tails, indicating they come from places where ice must be solid. But from which regions? From what distances? And most importantly, why did they keep arriving at the same frequency if it was evident they quickly disintegrated when they entered the inner solar system? There had to be a fresh supply of comets in a colder, more distant region. Much like in the Middle Ages, when people began to hypothesize the existence of lands beyond the Atlantic by examining branches and remnants of unknown vegetation that drifted to European shores from the West. If the twigs kept arriving for centuries, wasn't that a sign that beyond the ocean there had to be an inexhaustible source of vegetation? Similarly, people began to think about comets, and over time, continuous observations led to the belief that far beyond the sun and planets, there must be a large cloud of icy material and rock from which most of these comets originate. And if we said theorized and not discovered or proved, there's a good reason. Although thousands of articles have been written about it, its existence is still just a hypothesis, a scientific speculation. But from the analysis of the orbits of numerous long-period comets believed to come from those remote distances, astronomers claim to have even determined the structure and size of this immense reservoir of icy nuclei. The main characteristic of these comets is that the inclination of their orbits on the plane of the ecliptic, unlike what happens with planets and other objects in the inner solar system, covers the entire range from 0 to 180 degrees, suggesting that their source cannot be a flattened region like the asteroid belt or the Kuiper belt. Therefore, it has long been hypothesized that they all come from a spherical region surrounding the sun like a cloud of icy nuclei. As we can imagine today, the Oort cloud is an approximately spherical ensemble believed to surround the sun at a maximum distance of about 100,000 astronomical units, equivalent to 15 trillion kilometers, 9.3 trillion miles, or 1.5 light years. This places the outer boundary of the cloud in interstellar space, almost halfway between the Sun and the Alpha Centauri system. It is also believed that the ensemble consists of two distinct regions, an outer spherical Oort cloud, a kind of shell 80,000 AU thick, whose first extensions meet at 20,000 AU from the Sun, and a so-called inner Hills cloud, in the shape of a toroidal disk, extending from 2000 to 20,000 AU. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You'll help us to make products of even higher quality. These distances, relative to what we can call our backyard, already seem like abysses of time and space. Want proof? Let's take the fanciest thing in our universe, light. When light leaves the sun, it takes just over 8 minutes to reach Earth and about 4.5 hours to reach Neptune's orbit. Just under 3 hours after passing Neptune's orbit, sunlight crosses the outer edge of the Kuiper belt. After another 12 hours, sunlight reaches the heliopause, where the solar wind, a stream of charged particles flowing away from the sun at about 1,000,000 miles per hour, collides with the interstellar medium. Beyond this boundary lies interstellar space, where the sun's magnetic field has no influence. At this point, light has been traveling away from the sun for about 17 hours, already farther than any human-made spacecraft to date. Yet, somehow, it will take another 10 to 28 days for the same sunlight to reach the inner edge of the Oort cloud, and perhaps even a year and a half to pass through its outermost part. Impressive, isn't it? The outer Oort cloud could contain trillions of objects larger than 1 kilometer or 0.62 miles, and billions extending 20 kilometers in diameter, 12.5 miles. The vast majority of these are composed of volatile ices, such as water, methane, ethane, carbon monoxide, hydrogen cyanide, and ammonia. The total mass of the system is estimated very roughly. Calculations from a few years ago predicted up to 380 Earth masses, but a better understanding of the size distribution of long-period comets has led to much lower estimates, as little as 5 Earth masses. The Oort cloud has no sharp boundaries. Its outer edges extend as far as the sun's gravitational pull reaches, depending also on the position and movements of the nearest stars. The 100,000 AU limit likely considers the most stable part of the cloud, while the outer periphery is perturbed by our stellar neighbors. The inner boundary is also not sharply defined. The cloud flattens into a disk, and at about 10,000 AU, it becomes the so-called scattered disk, the most remote part of the solar system proper. It's where distant icy worlds like Sedna orbit, and perhaps where the so-called ninth planet of the solar system lurks. It's from this farthest region that long-period comets originate, before being stabilized by the gas giants into much shorter orbits, like Halley's Comet, for example. When Comet Hayataki passed 9 million miles from Earth in 1996, it was completing a journey of about 17,000 years, likely coming from the nearer regions of the cloud. Regarding its origin, until not long ago, it was commonly thought that the Oort cloud formed along with the protoplanetary disk that surrounds the Sun after its birth. However, more sophisticated and detailed models of our planetary system's formation show that the cloud exhibits different characteristics than it would if our star had formed in isolation. It is now believed that our star formed alongside hundreds of other stars tightly packed within a gas cloud, and that it later captured a large number of small icy bodies from these stars when it was still part of a cluster of newborn stars, thus creating its own enormous envelope of cometary nuclei. This new model suggests that the Sun gravitationally captured a vast cloud of comets as the young star cluster disappeared. If so, the cloud would contain a mix of material samples from a large number of stars closely related to the Sun, and it could be said that more than 90% of the comets from the cloud might have an extrasolar origin. To better understand how things went, imagine a scenario where icy nuclei spend most of their lives within the cloud, orbiting the Sun very slowly. Then, any gravitational disturbance, perhaps caused by the approach of another star, pushes a number of cometary nuclei towards the inner solar system on incredibly elongated orbits. Numerical simulations conducted in recent years have shown that stellar perturbations are sometimes far from mild. Statistically, it has been calculated that every million years, at least a dozen stars pass within 3 light years of the Sun, causing extremely violent perturbations. But the story of these icy mountains heading towards the Sun doesn't end here. The cosmic pinball game continues, and once they come within the gravitational pull of the gas giants, their orbits change again, this time in various ways. They can be expelled from the solar system or captured into much shorter orbits, becoming the so-called periodic comets. Okay, it seems clear, but wait, always be wary of the false security of numerical estimates. I must emphasize that everything said about the cloud in numerical terms, where it almost seems like its size and structure have been proven by precise observations, is actually the result of computer simulations. Take it or leave it. After all, the very laws of optics reiterate the impossibility of directly observing such a distant and faint structure. But how? Someone might ask at this point. We can see things at the edge of the universe, and we can't see something that is very close to us in astronomical terms? Just think about this. The optical resolution of our best space telescopes, whether it's Hubble, the James Webb Telescope, or Euclid, doesn't exceed 0.1 arc seconds, about 1/18,000th of the apparent diameter of the Moon. This means, for example, just apply some basic optical formulas, that none of these formidable instruments can ever observe objects smaller than 300 kilometers or 186 miles in diameter at a distance of 0.3 light years, about 62,000 AU. The smallest object that Hubble and company can resolve at this distance is nearly 730,000 kilometers, 454 miles in diameter, about half the diameter of the Sun. Similarly, it's possible to calculate that to observe an object 300 kilometers in diameter at that distance, we would need a telescope with a primary mirror of 11.6 kilometers or 7.2 miles. Alright, someone might object, but even the individual dust particles that make up the large and distant nebulae scattered across the Milky Way are unobservable, yet we can photograph the nebulae even with the modest instruments. So why can't we do the same with the Oort cloud? Well, the answer is simple. It's a matter of density. In nebulae, we see what we can call the fog wall effect, where millions of water droplets are hit by car headlights, light that is then refracted and diffused by each particle. For this to happen, in fog as in a nebula, the particles need to be very close to each other. This is not the case in the Oort cloud, where, despite their numbers, each icy nebulous is separated from the nearest one by distances measured in tens of millions of kilometers. In this situation, the fog wall effect obviously doesn't occur. Okay, but what about the potential clouds around other stars? Those where the matter would appear concentrated in a very small angular disk. Shouldn't we be able to see those? And yet, no. All we can observe around other stars are their debris disks, the equivalent of our Kuiper belt. So, what does the Kuiper belt have that the Oort cloud doesn't? Well, it's much warmer. The Kuiper belt is at least 1,000 times closer to the Sun than the Oort cloud is estimated to be. This means that the grains in the Kuiper belt are about 45 degrees Celsius or 113 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than the grains in the Oort cloud, which have temperatures only a few degrees above absolute zero. Now, a hotter star might warm an Oort cloud enough to avoid this problem, but the Kuiper belt is also much denser than the Oort cloud. In fact, the faintest debris disks we can detect are a million times denser than an Oort cloud would be. This explains why we don't observe extrasolar Oort clouds and why they wouldn't block our view of their star. They're simply too cold and mostly made up of empty space, leaving plenty of room for starlight to reach us. And then, do you want to know something curious? When we talk about Oort clouds around other stars, we immediately imagine them surrounded by a tiny fluff. But think about the potential Oort cloud of our neighbor, Alpha Centauri. If we could visualize it, we would see it in the sky as a sphere at least 50 degrees in diameter centered on the star. Not exactly a tiny fluff. To summarize, there are many clues about the existence of this phenomenal structure, but still no proof. And the beauty, or in this case, the downside, is that there are no observational experiments on the horizon that could enlighten us on the matter. What if the reservoir of comets isn't the Oort cloud, but directly interstellar space? What if the space between stars hosts billions of icy nuclei, which are then attracted by passing stars and transformed into comets. What do you think? Do you like this alternative hypothesis? Could you refute it?